back there. He probably put it out in the street.
Eddie upped his old tactics again.
Oh, God.
We've done some work. Yeah, that's gotta be bad.
I'm gonna hold the arms up on one of those hats for a little bit.
Eddie, not right now.
There he goes.
After 2 years of building it, make sure it don't get squashed by a truck.
That this often occurs to visiting us tonight a little later on in the show. And we'd just like to bring this to you. We will now show you a little bit of the evidence and give you your own imagination of what happened. As you can see, it was a tragic loss. But the man himself is going to be here to explain in just a few minutes. Mr. Edward James, thank you. We're back. And I'm here with Mr. Edward James. This is a man that's not unaccustomed to having these type of events happening to him in the past years. And here he is, Mr. Edward James. Mr. James, how you doing? We had a tragedy here today, and we just wanted to get some of the information on, you know, how much, we know you spent a lot of time and effort in this truck. Would you give us all the time and detail about this event?
Okay. First of all, this fire truck that you see on the table was an irreversible fire truck by radio control. 2 years of labor and time and money went into this particular hobby that I have.
Are you talking, what is the amount of money approximately?
Approximately, you see on the table here, $895 all, which if you look at it, it doesn't look like much. It looks like a bunch of broken pieces of bodies. And, but I must say I got two survivors out of the deal. The chief and the lieutenant survived the crash. The other six individuals were terminated. One was decapitated. Three had broken legs, which were amputated at the kneecap, and they bled to death. My poor fire truck is a hunk of junk.
Well, can you tell us what happened today? What were the events that led up to this?
Okay, here's what happened. I brought the truck down to demonstrate my talent, which I do have, even
on
though...
On New Jersey Avenue, right?
Yeah.
Right here where the parade goes.
Where the parade was straight and wild. I operated for about 32 seconds. It was fine until I got the bright idea of running under a fire truck, which I thought was stopped. But as you may see by viewing this film, a tragedy occurred. And a tragedy it was, because the rear wheel of a fire truck fell over a fire truck and it smashed it to hell. But I'm not going to give it up. I'm building a new one.
Can we see it here next year? We're going to see it here again next year.
Yes.
At the parade.
Yes.
Very good. Yes. It's a very noble. But you know, this is one event. We've heard, you know, events like this to you are not uncommon. We go back 1 year. What happened to you last year here? I hear stories.
All right. Last year, the last day of the convention, I'm bringing my clothes from my suitcase to my car. I walk out from underneath the overpass by the Seagull Motel in Woldwood, thinking nothing's good about to happen, but it sure as hell did, because it's straight in my back. 1, 2, 3. What happened? I wouldn't wish this upon anybody. I got dumped upon with a whole, what do you call it, tub of ice water mixed with beer, whiskey, wine, and you name it, it would have been there.
But this was not intentional, was it?
No!
Okay.
No.
I just want to make sure we ain't placing blame on it.
What happened was, at the end of the convention, they Gary dumped this water, which contained the drum of beer. I just happened to be at the wrong spot at the right time. And I got proof. And boy, did I stink.
Well, let's go back one more year.
Okay.
I think this involves us a little bit. We put something down for you to try.
Yeah.
And we'll let you take it from there.
Okay. You found it nice enough to bring down a jar of cherries, unpitted cherries, and a whiskey quart down jerk. I guess it was whiskey.
I think it was more grain alcohol.
Okay, grain alcohol. Same thing. You offered me a cherry. I took a cherry. And my rotten luck in September, I bit into the cherry thinking that it was free of the old pit. This was Robin. I bit down and my bridge work, the hook went into the back of my tongue. And I had to be taken to the hospital to get operated on, to get the clamp, because I couldn't get it out. You know how hard I tried, I couldn't get it out. And it hurt. Oh boy, it hurt. But the nurse comes in, and I'm in pain. She says, what happened? How did you get injured? I've eaten a cherry. He said, what?
True story again.
The whole thing is true, so help me God. Well, she busted that rat and she laid on the floor. The other nurse coming. She's working out. I've eaten a cherry and my bridge got stuck in my gum. Unbelievable. So anyhow, that's the end of that. They took me, operated, they got me the cramp off. And that was the end of that.
We hear other stories sometimes. Wildwood's not the only place that you have these kind of difficulties.
No.
We heard some kind of story about an airplane one time. Let's elaborate on that one just a little bit.
Well, this airplane was of the type that you control with the cables on a hand. My buddy and his son was with me, and the place was at that 17-year Quebec laboratory. There's a ballpark, and near the ballpark was a restaurant. So my buddy starts the engine up, and before I go any further, the plans for the airplane call for a 1 ounce gas tank. Now, I thought to myself, 1 ounce of fuel? How many times can I go around with 1 ounce? I put a 4 ounce gas tank. Okay, don't let it go. Once an hour, twice an hour, but the 15th time, I started to get a little dizzy. By the 18th lap, the plane made 2 laps before I made 1. And the cable wrapped around my throat, and I got so dizzy, I fell down and I broke my ankle. But the fellow that was with me, he fell on the ground laughing because the plane went zoom, zoom, boom. It cracked up. I'm laying with a broken ankle. He runs to the diner. He says to the cashier, quick, give me $1 of the change. I have to make an emergency phone call. She says, what happened? Well, he says, my buddy is flying an airplane, and he cracked it up, and he's hurt. Well, the whole diner just emptied out like ants when the bay blocks that. But he was stuck there with no chance. So he walked over to the cash register, pushed no chance, took a dollar of the change, put the dollar bill in, called the cash register, and went to the telephone to call the East Relative Police. Who was on the deck at the time was Lieutenant Schreiber, who at the time was very old and ready for retirement. He was very hard on him. So my buddy said to him, he said, well, my buddy is flying a model airplane, and he cracked it up, and he's hurt. But Lieutenant Schreiber misunderstood my buddy and thought that a real plane had crashed. In the meantime, my buddy hangs up the phone, and he runs up to me. He picks my leg up. He says, come on, Eddie, get up. Dick, I can't. My leg is broke. He picked my leg up and pulled like I passed out. I let one yell out and I passed right out. Boom! Okay. I come to and I hear these relatives fire horn going in. Call step fire horn going in. Woodridge fire horn going in. Rutherford fire horn going in. I said, gee, it must be a big fire for me. Right? Then I hear Hadley Heights going. I hear the sirens from Wellington. I hear Lindhurst's horn going. Gee, it must be an awful, awful big fire. And then I hear in the far distance, I hear North Arlington going. What the hell is going on? And the sirens and the air horn, blah, blah. They're coming closer and closer and closer. They're all coming to my airplane trail. Would you believe I had 32 pieces of apparatus there? And what did they do when they found out it was me? They put me in the old meat wagon with no springs and over the bumpy road on my poor ankle. Ba-doom, ba-doom, ba-doom. That was it. That was it. No more airplanes. I went into shit.
Oh, we're going to talk about this incident now here. You were trying to become the Navy type of man, right?
Yep.
Well, just for the records, what was the approximate price of the plane that you used?
Oh, about $75. And the engine was about $85. And the cable was maybe $20.
Alright, so this is by far the worst accident so far in your history.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Alright, this Navy experience, alright, you want to explain to us about this one?
There's
a location where this happened and what year about?
Okay. I would say it happened about 1979 or 80. I built this American Scout cargo ship. It's a five-hatch cargo ship. It's approximately 4.5 feet long, maybe 10 inches wide, and maybe 12, 13, 14 inches high. it took me 4.5 years to build this. And I took it to Indian Lake in Littlefield, which was a very calm lake. But when the wind blew, it got a little white cap. So I took the boat out of my station wagon, and I put it on the shore. I checked the controls. Everything was working fine, just like today. But again, disaster struck. On the main voyage, just like the Titanic, it sunk. It blew over and started to take water into number one hatch. Well, naturally, when number one hatch filled up, number two hatch filled up. After number two, the bow goes down, number three hatch filled up. The bow goes down a little more, and a little more, and a little more. Pretty soon, all you saw was the stern sticking out with the propeller going. All of a sudden, it took a deep six. What do I do? I run to my car. I get on my CB radio. I call my buddy who was a scuba diver. I say, Johnny, you got to come to Indian Lake and rescue my boat. It sunk. But before Johnny had a chance to tell me that he was involved in a motorcycle accident the night before, I shut the key up, killed my radio so I couldn't hear his response. I went back to my binoculars to see where the location was, where the ship took the deep sea. Well, when Johnny's car came around the bend, I noticed that Johnny wasn't driving. His girlfriend was driving. And that's a no-no to Johnny. Johnny never let his girlfriend drive his car. I said, oh, there's something. So I went over to the car. I opened the door. Well, I was shocked. Because there was Johnny's leg. Up to the hip in the cat. He said, hey, I can't go in there. My leg is in the cat. Do you have your stuff with you? He said, yes. Well, take my coat off.
I'll take that
for you, Mr. Jones. I put the tank on. Stop. Put the weight on, take my shoe off, put the slippers on, put the face piece on, put the mat piece in, and I go to the shore, hold my breath, and I jump in. And initially, I know that the lake was 90 feet deep, but I get down maybe 10 feet. I'll take a breath of air and go down deeper. I try to take a deeper breath and I go, chunk! The mask goes right to my nose, my eyes. I said, what the hell? I spit the face piece out and I go scrubbing through the surface. Gasping for air, and this Johnny, how you work? He said, I can't get no air. He says, did you open the air valve? I said, how the hell did you do that? He said, you pull that little lever here. Huh? Okay. I get air. Oh, I'm in heaven now. I go down. I don't. Boom! I hit my head. Ooh! Did I hit my head on something? But I opened my eyes. What I hit was the boom of a steam shovel. I said, what the hell is this doing down here? I said, shit. I'm forgetting about the boat. I'm getting up here. My head hurts. Oh, did I have a headache? Oh, I'm coming up to the surface, and the horizon with the light shining. I stopped dead in the water because this barracuda was coming at me. I swear to God, it was a barracuda because it was 4 foot long and it's going through the water. When I got closer to it, it was my boat. So I grabbed the boat and I paddled up to the surface with the flippers and I got the boat to the shore, but I broke all the superstructure, but I repaired the boat. I still had the boat. And I had to put 4 1/2 pounds of concrete into the bottom of the boat to make it ballast so that it wouldn't tip over in rough water. So that was the end of that story. And that's it.
Oh, Mr. Jabs.
But there was one more incident.
Oh, by all means, Mr. Jabs.
If you would like to...
Mr. Jabs, you have the floor. Be my guest.
All right. Now, I figured out I got the cargo ship mounted up in the alley. I said, I'm going to build President Kennedy's PT-109. 95 feet by Sterling models. It's about 3.5 to 4 foot long. Maybe 8 to 10 inches wide. About 10 inches tall. But I didn't do what the plans called for. I put live torpedoes on the PT boat, which were fired by remote control with CO2 cartridges. And in the head of the torpedo, I took shotgun shells apart, and I took the black powder off, and I let it equivalent to a half a stick of dynamite. And I made 4 torpedoes which operated by an electric battery, which fired by CO2 gas. And I entered it into a contest in Greenwood Lake, New York. Well, for target, I laid out 4 55-gallon drums that you get kerosene that I got from work. I filled them up half with water so that they would be partly submerged. And when my turn came to enter the contest, I let the PT book out on the lake. And I made my first pass at number one bell. Firewood, one fired, stayed through. Boom! The bell went deep set. Made a 90-degree turn. Fire number two. Number two fired. stay current. Boom! Number two bout, deep fit. Another turn to make number three target. Fire number three. Then fire. Straight cross. Boom! Number three dog. Deep set. One more to go. Yeah. One more. Another collision cross with the bow. Fire four. Four fires. Through the binoculars. Holy Christmas. It's gone haywire. Oh no. No. No, I can't look. No. Boom. I hit an 18 and a half foot cabin cruiser. It's not funny. I blew a hole stop 2 foot in diameter at the waterline, and the cabin crew go boom, 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 with people on it. And all the people on the shoreline, they're screaming, laughing, clapping, just like play. But to make a long story short, it cost me $5,000 to get the boat repaired, and the guy didn't press charge against me because, hey, accidents do happen.
Shit happens.
And it did happen.
Well, Mr. Jabs, being that that was his worst accident, this one seems a little minor to that one. But still, this was a tragic accident today. We all do really feel bad about it. But you have been a great sport, and you do have a good attitude about it, and we hope to see a refurbishing job and see you back next year.
Well, next year, if my health stays with me, you will see a model of the airport crash truck, okay, with workable air horns, workable siding, working lights, and a pump that will pump water through the turret nozzle, 28 feet, and the nozzle will be workable by radio control, right, left, up, or down. I hope to be done in next year. But, when I say this, but, it's not going to go under the wheel of a boat. That's the end of my story. I hope you had a good day.
Mr. Jabs, I know you'll be back next year and in good health, too.
Thank you.
Well, this is Charles Flenner from station KAR-839 with his funny man, cameraman, Louie, and his lighting director, Donna Marchetti, signing off for this year in Wildwood. Shit happens. See you next year.
Thank you.